Mic test. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the session today. So today we'll be talking about the resiliency framework for Airship using the Argo workflows. So before we get into the session, let me introduce myself. I am Pradeep Kumar. I work as a solution architect at Ericsson India. I also work along with the Airship community. So I contribute to the Airship community as well. I also want to introduce my colleagues here.
Hi, my name is Gurpreet Singh. I work with Imagineer Technologies and I'm as a senior development engineer there. And I'm a contributor to Airship community. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Kiriti Muktevi. I work as a senior development engineer in Imagineer Technologies and I also contribute to the Airship community.
Thank you. I also want to mention about Hemant Nagina, who has contributed for this product development, who could not be present today because of some personal reasons. His name is Hemant Nagina. He's also my colleague who works as a solution architect at Ericsson. Okay, so let's quickly move on to the agenda today. So today we'll be covering these topics that you see here. Firstly, I would want to let you understand why resiliency is important, what are lessons that we learned during our Airship development and our journey to into the Airship, and what was the reason why we chose to have a resiliency tool. So we'll just walk through that, and then I will also introduce you to the product Torpedo, which is the resiliency framework. We named it Torpedo, so I'll walk you through that, the introduction, and we'll also walk through the architecture and then core components, and we'll have a quick demo as well. Okay, so the primary important, I mean, I'm sure all of you are aware of cloud deployments and you must have gone through some background of cloud deployments, whether it's a medium scale, large scale or a small scale, and you would all appreciate why and how resiliency plays a very important role for all of us, right? So when we started doing the deployments for Airship, I mean, when we started with our journey on Airship and the containerized deployments, so we found that Kubernetes was something that was probably not tested completely in terms of how it would work along with the OpenStack and all the undercloud components. So we thought, why not have us identify scenarios which are very important, critical for production use cases, and have them tested in our labs so that we don't really counter those resilient scenarios in our production environments. So that's how we started our journey. And like we all know, I mean, some of the use cases, large use cases, why we have resiliency. So this is basically to deal with some of the unexpected failures in a distributed environment like a containerized environment. And with microservices coming into picture, so you would need to have a resilient system which are bound to overcome those failures, because we do have frequent pod failures happening during upgrades, and also some of the DB overload, or it could be log failures, I mean the log LMA log overload and other scenarios. So these cases we would want a resilient system which will counter all these issues. And like I told you, the downgrades and the upgrades are also one of those scenarios which we need to counter or have a resilient system as well. And most importantly, the stateful sets. I'll probably talk to you about the lessons that we learned. So we had some issues, or we've found some issues while we had the stateful sets. So we'll also talk about that during the demo. Okay, so introducing to Torpedo. So Torpedo, I'm sure most of us know what Torpedo is. Torpedo is basically an underwater missile system which will basically attack the enemy ships under the water. And it will help you, target those enemy ships. So just like how torpedoes are meant to attack the enemy ships, we thought our resiliency framework will call them as torpedo, which will attack those resilient scenarios and those failure scenarios. That is why we named them as torpedo. So to introduce this framework, so this is primarily we have tested and we have built this for Airship, but it doesn't limit ourselves to only Airship. So we also can extend this to any of the Kubernetes or the containerized platform. And we will talk about the different components while we move into the architecture there. And the reason why we wanted, again, why we wanted this robust framework for resiliency is because currently we do not have any framework currently. All of you must be aware, or you must have heard about chaos tools that we have, Cube Monkey and the Chaos Cube and several other tools. So if you know that, those tools just can kill the pods randomly, but you do not have any test cases which can be run against those systems, right? So when the pod failures keep happening. So this was meant to actually cater to those end-to-end scenarios for a resilient system. And again, we'll talk about the detail architecture and the different components within Torpedo. So the data sources, again, will provide the components on which resiliency tests are performed. So it provides the data sources that we need. And the most important thing is how we display or how we capture the results. So the results are very important.
Around it. So we can imagine an action scene from a typical action movie. Right, so we have a hero in between and all the villains attacking on it. Okay, so we have an orchestrator whose duty is just to sit around and send these villains to attack. Right, so meanwhile they're attacking, there are, we see destroyer and traffic generator. So there we have some chaos jobs which randomly go and kill the pods of particular service. Okay, and we have some traffic generator. Meanwhile, the pods are being killed. We are generating traffic to see if there is some latency, if there are some performance issues, and we're trying to see all that. And log analyzer and collector will just check the status from Airship and it'll report everything to ELK. Okay, so you see some, here we see T1, C1, T2, C2, right? So the one in green, C1, C2, these are all the chaos jobs. Okay, so here we can mention which service we need to target, what is the replica we want to kill, how much we want to, is there a particular node we want to target, and how it is going to work. Okay, and we see T1, T2, these are the traffic jobs. Okay, so it generates traffic depending on the service. It can generate get calls, post calls, all of that. Okay, and the log collector and analyzer, this will in the end give you a matrix which will tell you what is the pass percentage and failure percentage of the test cases. Okay, it will tell you that these many of the calls passed and these many failed, and it will send all the logs to ELK dashboard. The dashboard will, do all the data search you want to do there, and it will display everything. Okay, so here we see we have Torpedo metacontroller and Torpedo CRD test suite. So metacontroller is basically, it creates a CRD and triggers the Argo workflow. Okay. So we'll move to next slide. So these are the basic components we just covered: Torpedo metacontroller, orchestrator, Argo workflows, traffic generator, destroyer, and log collector and analyzer. Okay. So metacontroller is an add-on for Kubernetes to write and deploy custom controllers. Here we can deploy custom controllers, and we can create CRs to execute a particular test suite. Okay, user can define their own test cases, and custom Torpedo controller builds Argo YAMLs based on the inputs you want to give. Okay, so you'll be passing inputs as a job parameters, we'll see in the further slides. And metacontroller will take it and give it to Argo workflow, and Argo workflow will do the rendering of the existing templates of chaos and jobs, and it'll trigger the complete DAG. Okay, so these are all the activities an Argo DAG does. It creates traffic jobs, it creates chaos jobs, it creates sanity jobs, and log collection analyzer jobs. Traffic jobs, as we discussed, will generate some traffic, some get calls and post calls, and we'll see how the performance of the system is. Right now, the particular component we are targeting. Chaos jobs will kill the pods randomly out of the replicas we have. Sanity jobs are the sanity checks we can configure. Like, let's say if you are killing in OpenStack scenario, you're killing Nova pods. So you can do Nova list and all and see if the system is working fine or not. Okay, and log collection and analyzer jobs are, it will collect all the logs of the pod and it will push it to ELK. And analyzer, as we discussed, that it will give you the metrics as how many test cases passed and how many failed. So it is a traffic generator will generate the HTTP traffic. It is similar to Gabbit we have in OpenStack functional testing. Okay, it will generate API calls which are configured as YAMLs, and it is written as config maps. Okay, so it is a pluggable module. If you wish to add your own traffic calls, you should be able to configure it. Okay, now.
Yeah, just to quickly talk about the destroyer. Now, we spoke about how we can destroy or how we can randomly kill the pods and the resources on the Kubernetes. And he also mentioned about the metacontroller. He also mentioned about the log analyzer and the traffic generator. So the most important component here is how do you actually bring down the pods randomly? So we have developed a component called destroyer in the torpedo. So the destroyer mainly targets a particular namespace. It targets a particular resource type. It can actually be a pod, it can be a deployment, it can be various other things, labels, node labels, and so on. So we can mention them in the configuration file, and it would go and kill multiple instances, single instance of that particular resource type during destruction. And while the destruction is happening, while the pods are being brought down, you would be running some of the tests in the background just to ensure that none of the API requests are getting dropped or they are getting failed. So these results are being captured at the end, and that's how the flow would be. Now, like I told you, the important part is the destroyer. So this destroyer is capable enough of targeting different pods, arbitrary pod failures. It will capture those pod failures and say the pod did not come up if it's when the destruction is happening, and after the destruction if it doesn't come up. And it will also filter the pods by namespaces, labels, annotations, and it can also be excluded based on these parameters as well. And the most important thing is it can even capture the mean time between the failures of these pods. So these are the salient features of this destroyer. To give an example, we will again walk through this example in detail while we do the demo. But just for our understanding, we wanted to just show the example here. So if you see you can actually define the kill interval, you can define the kill count, and then you can give the pod labels, node labels. And the most important thing you can give here is the maximum nodes, which some of the open source products which we already see, like the Chaos Cube and the Cube Monkey and other products, do not really provide this feature, where you can actually tell how many nodes you want to actually bring down at a time. In your system, you might have designed 5 to 6 HA zones, right? HA nodes. So you can actually define saying, I want to bring down 3 out of my 5 or 3 out of my 6 nodes at a time to just see how resilient my systems are. Or if you want to just mimic one node's down scenario, you can as well do that. So you can define how many nodes you want to parallelly run this random pod destruction scenario. And the most important, again, component is the log collector. Now, since we have integrated this with Airship, so Airship in itself brings in the LMA module, which is consisting of the ELK and the EFK stack, the FluentD, Kibana, and Elasticsearch. And we are reusing that just to ensure that this is seamlessly integrating with the Airship ecosystem. So what we have done is we actually forward all these logs into the ELK stack that we already have with the Airship namespaces. And then once we have this, we are going to show or display all these logs about how many pods we failed during our tests, how many pods passed, and all those things on Kibana dashboard. Okay, so now let's get on to the demonstration. I'll hand it over to Kiriti for the demo.
Thank you, Pradeep. So in today's demo, we'll be covering three scenarios. One is testing the stateless pods, and other is testing the stateful components, and the final scenario would be we'll bring down one of the controller nodes and see how the system behaves. So in the testing of stateless component, there are again two parts to it. One thing, we'll just trigger a get calls, like execute an OVA list onto the OIPA pods, and we kill the OIPA pods. And in other scenario would be like execute a post traffic onto the Nova component, like we kill the conductor pods and just hit, we'll create a boot request to the VMs. So let's get on to the demo. So basically, we'll first have a look at the environment which we have created. So this is the environment currently we have. There are 3 master nodes which are controllers and 1 worker node which is compute. So I have deployed this using Airship. And since in this demo, we are primarily targeting the Nova pods and MariaDB pods, let's have a look at how many pods are present initially before doing any destruction. As you can see, there is a Galera cluster of three MariaDB pods, MariaDB server 12012. And we can see Nova API has a replica size of 8 pods. And Nova conductor as well as a replica size of 8 pods. Now we'll go through one of the test suites where we can explain in detail what each parameter is and what it can do. And we can, each test suite has, I mean, there is a master set of parameters and we need not define all the parameters in each test suite. This we'll be covering parameters necessary for each scenario as we move on. So initial section is like a keystone auth section. Where we give all the keystone related authentication parameters so that we can get the token from the keystone and proceed to our, when we are generating traffic, we can use the token. So the second section would be the job parameters. So here, if you can see here, there are multiple job parameters. Initial one is service and a component which we'll be saying based on our deployment, like if you want to target the heat engine pods, so there would be a label like application equal to heat and component equal to engine. So similarly, I mean, service part will be writing the first part, the generic component that is heat, and in the second part we'll say whether you want to target API pods or engine pods or any other things. So the third thing is like the service mapping. This service mapping, which we give here, the node drain is there, and it differs for each scenario which we take up. So here, the node drain is there. So there is a JSON which is being defined. Which contains the test case information. So which target to hit. So based on the service mapping, it would pick up that JSON from that file and would be initiating the traffic. And there are two parameters, job duration and count. Job duration is like how much time we need to execute, initiate the traffic or kill the pods. Say if I say job duration here as a 100 seconds, so I will be keep on hitting the heat engine for 100 seconds. And if I say, similarly for 100 seconds, we will be keep on killing the heat engine pods. Similarly, if job duration is given as zero, that means count would be taking precedence. Means how many number of times you want to execute a particular test case. So if you execute for a particular period like 100 seconds or 200 seconds, you want to execute 10 times each test case. You can define job duration as zero and count as 1 or 10 or whatever number of times you wish to execute the test case. So extra arguments is like when we actually extend the framework, we might need some more arguments or any particular special scenario of test case comes up and we need to pass on some more arguments which are not currently present. We can give it through extra args and parse it in our test cases. And there is also a feature to enable or disable any chaos or traffic. So if you don't want any chaos to happen, just want to test the traffic part, you can set the enable chaos parameter to false. And if you want just the chaos to happen, no traffic, you don't want to create any traffic, you can enable traffic to false. And we can go through the nodes and sanity checks part of it as we go to the fourth scenario where we bring one of the nodes down. The last part here contains the namespace which we are targeting. In this case, it is OpenStack, since heat engine is present in the OpenStack namespace. And the plugins part which we are doing, like the traffic and chaos plugin, they are configurable. We can integrate multiple frameworks into this torpedo. And the volume storage class depends on what type of storage you are using. Some might be using NFS storage, some might be using Ceph storage and all. So there would be a storage class created for each of the storage types. So if we can configure that here and give how much storage we need. And this torpedo can also be executed from a jump host, I mean, which is not there, not in the cluster. So from the, if you want to target from the jump host, then we can give these parameters, like we can enable the remote cluster and give the kube API endpoint on which we need to target, and the cluster to get authenticated into the Kubernetes. So as I said, initial scenario would be like we'll be hitting a get call to the Nova API pods. So in here, I have configured the max nodes to be two. I have three controller nodes. So for on that, I have configured it to be two nodes. I mean, two nodes I want to target. And on each node, I need to kill two pods. So my kill count would be two, max nodes would be two. So if I just here I'm triggering the test case. So for just for typing purpose, I have created a alias KUM, which means kubectl hyphen and metacontroller, which I mean because the pods are created in the metacontroller namespace, I just created an alias. So here we are creating a torpedo custom CRD. If you see here, torpedo OpenStack torpedo test CRD has been, I mean test suite has been created. And if we check the pods in that namespace, you can see this is Argo workflows are created here. These four pods represent the Argo workflows and the actual resiliency pods like traffic and chaos pods have been created. Sorry. So if we check the logs of the chaos pods, or as you can see here, out of the three nodes I have, it is filtering out two nodes and deleting two pods from each of the node. So it would all list all the pods that are present on that particular node, and on that it would select random two pods and delete them. So now we'll look at logs of the traffic pods. As you can see here, it would keep on printing pass when a success code is returned. And if any failure case has been encountered, it will print the entire stack trace. So as of now, there are no failures, so it is just keep on printing pass, pass, pass. And if any failure case has been encountered, it will give you the trace of the end log. So once all the jobs are completed, there would be a log analyzer job created, if as you can see on the top of the list. So this log analyzer pod would collect all the logs from the resiliency and chaos pods, collect it into a PVC, and do some analysis as how many it will pass through each of the logs and say how many test cases have been passed and how many have been failed, and then push them onto the ELK stack. It would generate a JSON report out of the test cases that have been executed. As you can see here, the test case would be Nova OS API, and the duration for which it is executed is 100 seconds. And the pass, I mean, these many test cases have been executed, out of them, 504 have been passed, and there are no failure cases here. And at the, as you can see here, these all are written to this particular folder, which is present inside the PVC. so that we can use it as a ephemeral storage and refer it to the further, I mean, further analysis we can use it. So this is the scenario one. In the next scenario, we'll be targeting the Nova conductor pods while we initiate a boot request to the boot, I mean, when we create VMs. So let's quickly go through the YAML, I mean, test suite that has been there for this. So here, if you can see, the major differences would be the service and component part and the service mapping. So here we are actually changing the service mapping to boot so that it would initiate a boot request. So now let's create this CRD. So as you can see, there is a CRD being created. There has been CRD has been created, and you can see the pods which are being generated through the CRD. If you see now, the OpenStack chaos test and traffic test have been created. So let's check the logs of these pods. And you can see here one of the VM has been created and it is waiting for it to come to active state. And meanwhile, the VM, by the time VM comes to active state, let's check the chaos part or the OpenStack server list, what it is. I mean, if you can see one of the VM which is in build state. So once, while this VM comes to active state, let's have a look at the chaos logs, what it is happening. As you can see, on each node, there have been three replicas of Nova conductor, and it is deleting a couple of them. As you can see, the VM is in active. Actually, this is the second VM. If you see the name on the VM, which is on top and which is on bottom, this is second VM because immediately after the VM comes into active state, we'll be deleting that VM. As you can see, there are multiple instances being created and deleted. Once the VM comes to active state, we'll be initiating a delete call to that VM. And at the end of the test, there would be a log collector again generated for this. And if you can see the logs of it, you will find, I mean, how many times. Here, the duration executed is around 180 seconds. And of that, we created a VM 10 times. And of those, none of the test cases have been failed. I mean, none of the VMs have failed to be come to active state. Now we'll get into a scenario where we delete the stateful components. So in this scenario, what we'll do is we'll be targeting the MariaDB cluster, which has been present. So we'll be targeting, I mean, we'll be deleting one of the MariaDB pods each time and initiate traffic to Neutron port list, I mean, port list, which in tact contacts the MariaDB server to get fetch the ports that are present in the cluster. So if you see here, we'll be again changing the service and component, and the service mapping here, we'll be setting it to Neutron so that it can execute get calls to Neutron. So here we will be creating again the CRD. CRD has been created. Now we'll check the pod logs. Let's check the chaos and traffic logs right now. As you can see, it is executing a get call to Neutron port list. And since the test case has been passing, it is just returning the pass message. as you can see, there are MariaDB cluster has three pods, and out of that, it is taking out MariaDB server 0. So once the test case has been completed, the log analyzer would again come into picture. It would pass through entire logs and generate a report. As you can see here, the duration of this execution is around 300 seconds, and 3,358 requests have been initiated, and none of them have failed. So after all the logs have been generated, immediately after the log analyzer job completes, it will be pushing all the things into the ELK stack. As you can see, the initial, we have two levels of representation in the Kibana dashboard. Initial one is based on the timestamp at which we have executed the test. And if we click on one of the timestamp, it will redirect us to a page where it gives the detailed, the report which has been shown. As you can see here, there is a JSON report which we have had earlier. It is represented in a graphical format in the Kibana dashboard. So now we get on to the final part of this demo. So this is where we bring down one of the controller nodes, and we'll see how the system behaves. So for this, what we are trying to do is, before bringing down any node, we'll be initiating a heat stack creation, which will be creating 8 VMs inside OpenStack, and immediately deleting the stack. And afterwards, it will bring down the node, and again initiate the heat stack. So whenever the heat stack is successful, it would be the exit scenario for the test case. So until unless heat stack is successful, it will keep on creating the heat stack. So it will give a timeout of 15 minutes. So within the 15 minutes, if heat stack doesn't comes up, it would initiate, it would delete the existing stack and initiate a request to the new creation of a new heat stack. So whenever the system, is able to create a new heat stack, then it would be exiting. That job would be exiting. So as we can see here, the initial part would be the same, and service and component again would be heat engine. And the service mapping would be torpedo node, node drain. And here we'll get, we'll configure what nodes we want to delete. So this is like IPMA IP on which we want to target, and the node name on which we, the IPMA credentials which we want. Okay. Then we also can configure the sanity checks. This is like we can configure anything to run alongside with it. Suppose you don't want just to analyze based on the heat stack creation only. You want additional metrics related to some other component. So you can configure any number of things here. So right now, what I have done is I have initiated a get call to each of the OpenStack component. As you can see, the initial one, Nova get call, Glance, Keystone, Neutron, Heat. And we can also collect the pods before the any destruction has happened, and after a destruction, what is the state of the pods, and what is the state of the nodes each step. At a given point of time, what is the state of all the nodes in the cluster, and what is the status of RabbitMQ pods. Like that, it is all configurable. You can add n number of sanity checks can keep on for additional metrics. And now we'll create the test suite, torpedo CRD. As you can see, there are number of pods that are getting created, like sanity checks, the node list and all. So we'll just have a brief look at each logs which has been generated. So we look at the glance, logs of sanity checks of glance. As you can see, it would be initiating a get call to the image list. Now we'll just check heat. Again, heat stack list, there would be a get call for heat stack list. Now we'll be checking keystone part. It would be initiating get call for the endpoint list. And neutron, as we have observed earlier, it would be the port list. And no, this would be a server list. Now just we'll do an EXC into one of the ports to check into the PVC what are being recorded over there. So if you can see here, there are four parts here. One is debug report, which collects logs of all the pods that are present in the cluster from all the namespaces. And the node list would be keeping on hitting until the test case is finished. So it will always record what is the state of the nodes in the cluster. And the pod list would it would be collecting based on the timestamp what is the state of the pods at the particular given time. And if you can check the RabbitMQ logs, you can see there is a RabbitMQ cluster of two, and you can see the disk has two nodes, and running nodes are two at this point of time. As you can see, the nodes are all in ready state right as of now. Since that heat stack might have not have completed at this point of time for initiating node draw. So let's check now what is the state of the nodes. As you can see, the first node has been not registered because it has been taken down once the heat stack is completed. And if you see the logs of this torpedo node drawing, the last one. Here you can see initially it is waiting for heat stack to complete it, and then it is deleting the stack, and then it is powering off the node, and again it is initiating a heat stack creation request. So once that is completed, it would come out of the test case. Thus it is a success scenario. And after that it will power on the node. So you can also configure number of nodes to take down. Like if you just have a huge cluster and you want to test it when three or four nodes go down, you can still configure it as a list in the nodes parameter, give all the list, it would bring down one node after other and test the same thing. Yeah, that's for demo. Pradeep will take up the next steps which we are planning to implement in this torpedo.
Thanks, Kiriti. That was definitely a deep dive of torpedo. I'm sure all of you would be interested to know more about this. So just to give me a moment. So if you want to learn more about torpedo and just to know what are the next steps that we have planned, so the first one would be that we want to although we have designed this for Airship currently and we have tested them, we have identified a lot of complex scenarios while we develop this framework. So we are continuously adding more and more test cases, complex scenarios that we learn while we are doing the testing, the resiliency testing. So we are continuously adding that. And some of the things that we plan to add are the Ceph storage resiliency scenarios and also the rack down. We saw the node down. So the rack down scenarios would be the extension of the node down scenarios. So we would want to also check that to ensure that we have a reliable system when there is a complete rack down failure due to power outages or any of those typical scenarios. So we also want to extend torpedo to some of the other frameworks apart from Airship, like the Google Cloud. We want to have the plugins extenders for the Google Cloud, AWS, Azure as well. So that is another plan that we plan to. In fact, we plan to have the spec submitted for Airship under the OpenStack Foundation very soon. and that would be in alignment with the Airship 2.0 as well. So that's where we plan to have it contributed. And then apart from that, we also have we are doing some research on how we can add more and more tool sets into Torpedo, so that we have wide range of capabilities added into Torpedo as well. So this is the plan. And yes, we are available for questions if you have any. I don't know what is the time. I think we are probably just on time or maybe a little over time. So we are available for questions. Couple of quick questions if you have any. Absolutely, that's right. So you can actually use the Azure Kubernetes cluster. So if you're using, what we are planning to do is you can have a multi-node cluster along with some of the public cloud platforms as well. So we want to bring down, as we know, we cannot extend the node down scenarios for some of the public cloud scenarios, right? You cannot bring down a node down on Google Cloud or Azure. So you would not be able to extend all of the scenarios, but if you have a hybrid cloud or an instance on Google Cloud or Azure, we also want to create some resiliency tests in terms of how the latency would behave in case one of the pods on the private cloud is down, and then you have only the instances available on GC or Azure or AWS. So we would want to ensure that we cover those scenarios as well in case of hybrid or a public cloud totally. Okay, so if you don't have any questions, thank you. Thanks a lot for attending this session. Great to have you here. And you can always reach out to us if you have any questions. Thank you so much.
Thank you all.